hope that everyone takes it as a very informal kind of forum, and we can really have discussions, critics, whatever we want about the topics of what he presents or larger topics about the profession. So I will let Lorenz talk about his office and work. just one word. I'm really excited to invite him here because they've now been working, I don't know, 25 years or more, Topotek, really at the intersection between landscape, architecture, and urbanism. And I think that this interdisciplinary approach is really exciting and worth discussing. So thank you very much, and hand it to you, Lorenz.
Thanks a lot, Zoltan. It's a pleasure to be here. It's just told us my second time in Budapest after 31 years. Do you know how old I may be? I have been here in with the university, with the Hanover. I studied in Hanover, and we had my second university trip after going to Berlin from Hanover. Was Budapest, and so, I said I just came from the airport, to be honest. But what I've seen is that the lighting concept in the inner city completely changed. That's what I've seen, but nothing more, unfortunately. It was not bad before. It was just not so opulent, I would say. Okay. May we have a bit less light? That would be great. Because if not, you won't see anything. Even less. Better. Is that okay? Yeah, much better, I guess so. No, I don't need light. Later. You can hear me. Later, you will see me. So, I've brought some projects from the office. And I try to, so these are kind of couples. So they are only always two projects which are a bit combined, which have something similar, something the same idea. And there are four of these couples, and I would try to start with the first. We are in the valley. You don't hear me, no? That's better like this. We are in the valley, in the Rhine Valley. Maybe this way. It's better like this. Between Frankfurt and Mannheim and Heidelberg, in that area, in the German part of the Rhine Valley. And we got a project, it's 10 years ago now, about an old monastery, which is nowadays more or less gone. It was one of the most powerful and interesting monasteries of the Middle Age area, we'll say between the 8th century and the 12th or 13th century. But the most interesting part of the, because it's now it's World Heritage, was that there was a library, and in this library they copied a lot of books, especially I would say more than 50% of the information and the books of the antiquity, of the Roman and Greek antiquity, has been copied in Lorsch. And nowadays we only have the copies left and not the originals. So without this library, without this monastery, we would have lost a lot of knowledge of the antiquity. Therefore, it is now World Heritage. There remain some leftovers, I would say. I even would say ruins. It is not this picture. This is Dorset in England. But for our approach, what we can do as landscape architects with this monastery, which was in a very bad shape when we came, Our idea was just to do a frame, just to do a very perfect frame, like in England, like this perfect lawn, which we can see only in England, and which let that what is there, if it's ruins or architecture, or let it be visible and better visible than before. These are just inspirations we had when we started. And it was as well the question, how can we show something which is not anymore there, or the architecture which is gone? And on the left side, on the left, I think we can have a kind of feeling we see that there is something gone, or we see here that there is something gone, or there has been something there. So the idea in the end was just to work with footprints in a green lawn and to do nothing, to do nothing more, just to work with a kind of topography and with a clear frame and surroundings. So you see here what is left over on the right side is just there, just very few architectures. So you see these part of the church, for example, and this kind of little strange building on the right side. So the area is an old sand dune on which we just formed, or we worked on the topography. And in the end, the idea is that the people can walk wherever they want. There are more or less no footpaths. There are some footpaths. You see this kind of Mikado round way, and but this is just visible, or you can see that this is something new and this is not something historical. You see some of these pictures. Is there a pointer somewhere? No. Maybe if you have one, I would like to have one. And this is the way how it appeared. So for example, this building is not a monastery building, it came afterwards. You see that it doesn't fit exactly to the ground of the old buildings. And here, for example, the part of the old church which is gone, and the cloître, the Kreuzgang, some of these footpaths. And you see with how this kind of this topography, this of this sand dune works as well together with the mountains of the horizon. This is the way we wanted people to use it, and they are doing it. Some reminiscence, some trees just standing. Part of the old wall as well, this topography, this dune, and this round footpaths, which is clearly saying, I'm new. I'm using old material, but I'm new. This is the second, or one of these, on the right side, one of these old, one of the architecture, this is from the 8th century. We don't know exactly what it is. It's like a special building. But it's not a church like it seems to. So it's a kind of people walk through. There has been an access. We showed this access as well. And it's one of the oldest architecture, non-Roman architectures in Germany. You see the second part, the part of the church, which has been used for a long time as a farm building afterwards, after the monastery was gone, and how it sits as well in this kind of footprint, which is this kind of 35, 40 centimeters depression in the situation. Maybe just one word, it is not a real depression. In the end, we hired the other area, because inside of the soil, of course, there are a lot of ruins, walls, which are hidden, and of course we can't. We just filled up, and not we didn't excavate in this situation. So here we can see kind of all over view. A second project in that way is an older project. I think the city of Wolfsburg asked us 20 years ago to work on a park. Wolfsburg, maybe you know, is the head of the German car factory Volkswagen, and this was built for this factory. The old Wolfsburg, which has been before, is this part, and is not bigger than what you see here. The rest is a construction of the 30s under the fascist period. Here we have this is a kind of Weser Renaissance building, but in the end the park is an English landscape garden, an English romantic English landscape garden, but without any qualities. And the city asked us, they had a garden show, and they asked us to do something with this. It is, or it was, and it is listed as a heritage. And so it was not too easy to work on that. This as well, just to have a look to an, I would say, classical English landscape garden. Storer had one, some of you will know that. So an English landscape garden, a real English landscape garden, consists out of, not only out of trees, there's only always a reflection pool, a lake or a river, and there's a lot of follies, a lot of architectures, impressive architectures, from the antiquity, normally, or from China, or whatever. But in the end, there are always these kind of attractions, and you walk from attraction to attraction. This is the principle of the English landscape garden. And you have like a film or pictures, one picture after the other, the way leads you to one of these pictures after the other. So all this comes from the painters of the late Baroque, like Poussin and Lorrain, who already painted all these gardens. And in the end, in England, starting in England and then in whole Europe, they have been realized something like that, or different, or whatever. But so, in the end, two things for us, two things have been really necessary. To get this kind of attractions in the garden, somehow to renovate it as well, and to find this kind of footpaths, to this called belt walk, that you can really walk through the garden and have a walk of whatever, 1 hour or 1 hour 15. This is the time, like a film, we like to walk in such a garden like that. And therefore I show this picture here, and this kind of walking and the movement was really part of the garden, and was new in that time. So this is the plan of the park. In the end, we doubled its surface. So we convinced the city to get more land, to get, because it was very small, to get part of the landscape outside of the old garden. And you see these kind of round dots there to put there the attractions. This is part of the new footpaths. And these attractions, and these are round gardens, circular gardens, which work as well with reflection. So we said we would do something new, something modern, because we can't do something, we can't do ruins, and it's completely strange. So we do something modern, and we work with reflection, like the landscape garden works as well with reflections, but out of steel in that way. So it hides himself, this kind of, there is a hiding, but as well, on the other side, there is something interesting and new. So in front of the castle, of the old castle, it is a closed space. You can just look through. And inside was an installation situation. This was the installation of the garden show. Later, there have been other installations of this garden. Another one situated in the forest was kind of forestal garden with some plant attractions and like a labyrinth. So the round form was kind of displaced and in a kind of labyrinthic form, new arranged. And there was a third one, here we took one of the themes of the garden, of the typical garden shows in Germany, so the rose. And so here was kind of fragmented and had a real exposition, possibility. Another way, or another question was, in sort of the renovation of the park, how to work with all the other facilities, with all the other furniture we need for a park. There was nothing besides some white benches like here, which came out of the formal English garden, which is just 100 years old. The park has more than 200 years. So we asked the city to throw them out. The city said, no, we just paid them. And then we said, okay, maybe there is another way to deal with this. And we painted them in rows. And so this was the start of a kind of color concept, new color concept for the park, together with this kind of rubbish bin. We called it hide and seek. So we just wanted him not to be there. So we put this kind of synthetic grass on it to make it invisible. As well, there have been some lawns where they had horses, a lot of horses. There's a bit tradition there. And we have been able, or we had been able, to incorporate them in the park, and to do a new system, barrier system, as well in the color concept, of course, and as well the addition of flowers had been always in this color concept. To be honest, in the English landscape garden, there are no colors; they're just greens. So colors here are completely visible as something additive, as something new, as something modern and not historically. So how to read that, what we are doing, is always for us something which is important. The next couple is talking about identity, participation. I'm just coming back to that example of the English landscape garden. What is as well interesting on all these architectures and folies in the English landscape garden? This is as well, this is the same garden as Stourhead, this temple of Apollo. It comes directly, but as I said, from the paintings. So there is a transition process from the paintings. The paintings have been first in reality in the garden. But as well the paintings, of course, they're coming, this kind of temples, they're coming from something. So the original was something else in the antiquity. So this process for us is very interesting, because in this process things change. Sometimes people want to change things, sometimes it's by accident, but it's always interesting what comes out of that and how objects can change in that process. And I think exactly this was for us part of the concept of another project. I have another example, just to have here, the Castel Sant'Angelo, you know, this is in Rome. This in the paintings of the late Baroque, they already moved somehow. Here is an Arcadic landscape, and the castel is appearing here somewhere. The Arcadic landscape, I don't know, nobody knows exactly. It should be Greece, but can be everywhere. So it can move as well. And this we found interesting. What I'm talking about is the project Superkiln we did together with Big and Superflex. Maybe you know it because it's very well published. So I don't explain the whole story, but that what is interesting for us, and this is the participation process and the way how to get identity in a new, completely new park. In the end, it's a completely new park. The existing situation is you can see here, is an area in the north of Copenhagen, which is where a lot of immigrants. And the idea in the end was to create this new park and to activate it, to bring the people to contribute something to the park and to try to get them the possibility to identify themselves with the park. And our idea in the end was that all the people should bring an object from their life. Can be from somewhere in the world. It was not defined, but everybody should bring, or a lot of people should bring objects. And all the objects of the park, and really every object should be selected, should come from somewhere, and should not be the usual Danish object they would bring normally in a kind of park like that. This, in the end, we had a process, a participation process over 2 years. I must say, I never had this before, I never had this afterwards. We had a budget for that. In Denmark, this is possible to do it. And we knew, when we did the concept, we knew that this would be possible. And therefore, we tried that. So in the end, this is a model we did for the public consultations, for the public presentations. In the end, like usually, we try to get people to get people with us, to discuss them, to present, and to try to make them understandable what we try to do. But there have been a lot of other levels, I would say. So we published a lot of articles in all kinds of newspapers, even if in the gratis newspaper you get automatically in your apartment. We had a website, an interactive website where everybody could work with. We had a kind of advertisement where we already started to propose objects, And where the first objects which have been proposed by the people have been listed and showed, etc., to bring people to have ideas to objects. I will show you afterwards. The next level, and I think the very interesting level was to try to integrate actively people or actors from the surrounding, from the neighborhood. And together with them, we selected, or they selected with our help, they selected objects, special objects. For example, there was a rap club, a small rap club with them, and with them we went to Jamaica, and this sound system which you see on the right side there, we selected that there, and installed that on the square. And you have an app, and you can play in special times. You can play music there. There have been some Danish who always went to Spain, and they loved this kind of bull, of Osborne bull. So we organized an Osborne bull to bring it to the park. There was a Thai kickbox club somewhere completely hidden, and we tried them to bring them in the square, on the square, that they as well can activate the square, but as well other people can use it. That was a journey to Thailand. And there have been some young who wanted to have a Palestinian flag in the park. And our work was to find something else, because a flag might be provocative. And this we didn't want, so we tried to find something else which could work. And the idea in the end was to bring soil from Palestine, where their grandmothers and grandfathers lived and had to go away because of the war in 48, the Israeli-Arabian war. The last thing was a dance pavilion as well, from some Danish people, who a dance club, which we selected and rebuilt in the area. So in the end, we arrived to a lot of pictures, to a lot of images, to a lot of pictures, which we then translated in the situation in the park. The interesting thing is that all these objects, all this collection of objects, changed, of course. And this was, so they get, they have been not something originally exactly what they have been, and they changed in a kind of Danish art, I would say. They get a bit of a mixture out of that, what they had to be. And a new Danish art piece. I have two examples, I guess. So this one, and this was nothing we proposed, this was something which has been proposed. And this is what we made out of it, or how it changed in... This is... So you see, it works as well in the night. So you see how that changed in the end, and how that is that comes interesting. We talked about that. Oops. So something. This we've seen as well, is the music installation box and the kickbox. The kickbox ring, which is very well used. And of course, we rebuilt all that. So it was not, we didn't import these things, so we rebuilt them. And they all, of course, changed quite a while. And this kickbox, in the end, this is it is part of a bit that idea how to deal with conflicts. So we can say there are no conflicts in the public space, but we can try to find a way how to deal with them and to work with them in a way which is okay for everybody. So these are the young ladies with the soil from Palestine, which has been there. Today is not any more visible, but has been visible for years. This red soil. So, just maybe for some seconds, these have been films we did together. Maybe one sentence. Superflex have been artists, and they did the films, so they took care of the process of these journeys to Thailand, to Palestine, to Jamaica, and so on. And these are just some images out of that. And in the end, what we tried, I think we it worked, because all the people of the neighborhoods, they are somehow bind to that new park. And we had some problems because some of the objects, because they have been newly done, some of the objects haven't been hard enough and have been so often used that we had to replace them or to repair them. But we didn't have a problem of destruction. So no, there was nobody tried to destroy these things. So that has been good. And that is maybe has something to do with the process that everybody was aware of what we are doing there, and had a part, and had something or some objects which have been close to him. This is the whole park. And what is interesting, and what happened afterwards, is that this park produced thousands of images. So from the image to realization, and then again to images, in a kind of incredible way. And so it was. It changed, but it was funny because we found advertisement pictures or whatever by coincidence, and but it was nice to see that reality again goes to images, and then that this process goes further and further. These are just some examples we have been sent from friends all over the world. It was very funny. The iPhone advertisement was really good. So this is completely new. This so the city of Copenhagen put that on the front of their tourist information. So another project, a small project where we worked a little bit similar, or we are working because it's not finished, is in Paris, in La Défense, behind the big arc, where there is a big transformation process. If you know La Défense, is a part of the city which is constructed in the 70s. The people are walking on plus three, So this is the idea of the 17th of the future. So what they are doing at the moment is that they try to change that and to find the ground again and to mix everything. So to mix these social housing, which we can see here, to mix that with more expensive housing, housing and office, so to get a kind of European city out of that, modern or old European city out of that. There was as well a participation process, but à la française. That was one meeting. And there was no money, and we decided then to talk just about functions. That was quite good, because there have been a lot of people, young people as well, old people, and we really had an outcome, but function-wise. So what do you need, and where do you need it? We didn't talk about design. Nothing at all. That was our part, and that works. If you do it like that, it's clear, and then it is a clear process. If you could spend more time and more money, but if the client doesn't want or is not able to do that, it's like that. So this was the image out of that. In the end, what we tried is. Or what we're trying is an activation of the open space in front of this social housing and the new mixture, I would say. And our idea was to bring, for all these functions, to bring really cool objects from all over the world, like we did that in Superkiln as well, but with another... So it was us to decide what we will do. And these are some first pictures. It's still in work, so it's not finished. And you see the new on the left side, the new buildings, which are replacing the parking garage, and some of these users, which we've seen before. So they really came. So it was really. It worked like that. And as well, a color concept, of course, and really to try to bring an activation for all ages, for all people, and to have as well a kind of special lighting concept, as well, like in Superkiln as well. We hope that the owner of this social housing is one day arrives to do his first floor here and to do the facade. You see there's really where the bridges have been, and but they are not. They wanted to do that before, but then they didn't have money and time. And we hope that they will do that afterwards somehow. And this is the part which is just in construction at the moment, so playground sculptures. And you see as well here objects, all objects are coming from somewhere. So there is the trash bin, that's from Paris, this is the only one. And yes. So third couple. Transformation. This is a project near Copenhagen again. Quarter, a real new quarter, a living quarter, and a park. And the idea, in the end, it was clear from the beginning that we had to get rid of a lot of water, a lot of storm water, and to deal with that. Our idea was to do a big concrete sculpture which can be used like this, or can be filled with water and has another quality. These are animations. This is not the real. The real comes afterwards. But they're good. So really to work with this, and so this is the theme of the park we're doing there. The construction is not finished, but nearly. So it's maybe interesting to have some views, and you can your imagine how that works with the water afterwards. And it's really play. It's really playful in the end. There was of course we did a half pipe with all the concrete. This was the opening of the first part. No? Oops. Yes. So you see a plan. So it's green as well. And as well in the green, we'll have possibilities to stock stormwater. Is visible here. But normally this is just for heavy rain. Then we go to the green areas. Normally we just the water just stays in the concrete areas. Of course there is a planting concept with adapted plantings, with adapted trees, resistant to the new conditions we have everywhere. There's a big theme. Of course, there is a furniture concept. Some more pictures from the situation. Somehow you see that filled with water. There is one permanent area for water as well. You see the construction still ongoing. Yeah, here we have a bit an overview of these areas. The second project is as well a restructuration of an existing area in Zurich. There where the red point is, this is from the 70s, the image. Is a sports park, and it's not completely new. In the end, it is new, but there has been a sports park before, which looked like this. And there was a competition. We finished the project in 2010, 10 years ago. And the idea of the competition was once to really to integrate the new park and the new sports fields in the city. So we created the alleys, we created the connections to all sides of the park. To have in the middle a real square, special object. So to see it as a part of the, really to see it as a part of the city, not as a landscape. And secondly, to say we need as well an identity, and the identity here could be green, because sports fields are already green, so we can push that, we can do more green, and that gives a kind of special quality. And we said that we will try to do every object, every fence, everything, as a special object or as a designed object. So color and design. And that's what we in the end did. So the fences have been object. This was a kind of double fence fence which we invented was used for the mountains to hold back the stones in the mountains, the Swiss product. And we used that here double in two different colors, which had the big opportunity was that these kind of fences, when you look from the side and you see that maybe in some of the photos, they become volumes. So they really like part of the city, like a built volume, but as well, if you stand exactly before, you can look through and you have this kind of nice effect. Here we can see that, this volume. And we see as well the lamps. So every object, in the end, every object turned into green. Oops. As well these, to get this special atmosphere. As well the architecture, which doesn't have been done from us, but as well the architecture turned into green, and have been part of this. And you see as well the two colors here now is this kind of yellowish from one side. So the inner side was yellowish, the outer side was green. And we tried really to work on every object besides this transportable there. This we didn't, came later. And we got this kind of moiré effects between these two layers of the fence. Details, special details to grab the ball, because we did a bit more fences than usual, so that they can catch the balls. We made these holes. Then the next pair is how to deal with existing situation to add things, maybe. So here the project was the Place de l'Europe in Luxembourg, a finished square done some years ago, but a kind of dead. And the city asked us to implement something, so to do something with that. And in the end, we said we didn't want to touch it. We just wanted to add something. So and something visible, something real, and as well kind of using concept, a special using concept. So that what was real in the end was this kind of wooden structure, which we just put on top, so all the trees have been preserved, and just a structure to use in different ways. And at the second time, we discussed a festival concept with them for different festivals, food truck festival, etc., to use the space in special attractions, in special periods, and that's in the end what worked. And so there have been possibilities to use the square in a different way, on two levels, I would say. So this was the one project where we added something, and the last, I think this is the last project. The last project I want to show is again, you remember this park in Wolfsburg. There was another question, I think a few months before we finished the park, and then they asked us for a temporary playground, and we did that. And the temporary playground looked like this. So we worked with inflatables, with a system of inflatables which partly existed. So we worked that out, and we followed. You remember maybe the color concept, and we followed our color concept which we had, and it worked perfectly. So this was a playground just for one summer in this green park. And here's some pictures of the summer. And afterwards, there was a next use, and we discussed it, of course, before. So the city used this playground every summer somewhere else. And sometimes we borrowed that, and then the garden started somehow to travel. And this was our 10th anniversary, so we traveled to Berlin. And then a bit around the world. This is the architectural biennale in Venice. It was a few years later. And for us, I would say, we can call that as well a kind of a moving garden, because what is a garden? A garden is something where you go in another world, where you have different situation. Maybe the smell is different. This is as well a different smell, and you behave in a different way. This is the interesting thing, and you're traveling like a lot of things in the garden history traveled as well, and some. We produced some more for some museums or expositions, and it really turned. We had them in China, went all around for strange parties in Berlin, and this is a few years ago in Verona for a festival, the Toccati festival, and I must say it always worked well. And I think that's it. Yes. Thank you. Bit long.
That's perfect. Thank you very much. So, can we get some lights again? Maybe?
And also, for you. Yeah.
I don't know if we have another microphone or not, but now open the floor to any questions, discussion, everything, if anyone has. If not, I will get it started, but I'll have to try to pick one question only. Anyone? Maybe I'll start. So thank you very much for the presentation. It's really great to see, especially some projects that I don't know that are quite new. I wanted to ask, it's not really a question, but maybe if you could talk a little bit about your approach. So I think to me, it's I know you have different facets of work, but in the landscape architecture work, it's as architectural as it could get, I think. I mean, I don't know all the work that's going on. And so I feel there's somehow I feel like it's purposeful, or there's an awareness. I mean, even this, the very first project you showed, the imprints in the landscape, I mean, it could be built, right? So it's with hard edges and straight edges, and this kind of interesting contrast between what's natural and what's built, and then especially most of them, you're working with the public space, so it's also between, you know, it's not really nature, it's not really the city, it's kind of this intersection between the two, and I don't know how much of that is intentional, how much of that is just kind of accidentally developed over your process over the time, or maybe you can add any words to that.
I would say it's all of that. So there are accidents, there are real accidents, which we use then. Um, uh, there are ideas which we had from the beginning, for example, the superkiln, which we seen the idea to do this kind of world park or a world garden that everybody brings an object, that was quite at the beginning. So the project was done in the end. The rest was how to do it and to select the objects, but the project was done. And in this case, and this is a good example, it was the client who started that, because the client said, do something with immigration. Okay. We said, okay, what should we do with immigration? And he brought that. So in the end, it was the client and of course we, but it was not a long process. So it was like that. And in other project, it took more time. In Lorsch, for example, it took a bit time. So we had the idea of the imprints, but then we somehow worked with... Yeah, it was not like clear like that. So it took time to reduce and always reduce and reduce to come just to this, to do more or less nothing. So this is always a long work. And, or for example, we had the idea of footpaths. We have to do footpaths. We can't do a park without footpaths. And then we said, yeah, we would like to have no footpaths, but... And then the client someday he said, we don't do footpaths. We said, okay. So, you see, it's always discussion, and it's always different, and we love accidents, to be honest. And therefore, I had this... as well to show with these follies how accidents, there are more examples, of course. So accident is something creative, and you know that, therefore you asked.
Yeah, Chava.
I want to ask you, we are architects, so me, I'm an architect, and my question is that how can you collaborate with them, for example, in this Copenhagen project? What have you done and what have the architect done?
You're talking about the architects? Yeah, so BIC, I think BIC you know, you should. They have been very young when we collaborated. They have been a kind of, we call them the boy group. And so they started, they have been on the way to start, the re-2. So they're the big airplane they are now, the Boeing 747. And in the end there, so the concept was we three. And I always, because BIC is always publishing at BIC, and you don't see anyone else, and we don't like that. Because you see our work, so, but they're nice as well. But I think as well the Superflex guys did a great work in organizing, these journeys, in organizing the participation process. That was really a big part of the project. In the end, we did the project together, we did the concept together, we selected all the objects together with BIC. And then we divided the objects. So BIC did, I didn't show that, there are some kind of architectural pavilions. This was the work of BIC. And we did all the typical landscape stuff. So that in the end, it was like that. And BIC had a bigger role in the local process, because they have been in Copenhagen. So that helped a lot, I must say. But the typical landscape, all the surfaces and the smaller objects have been done by us. So we divided it afterwards, but the concept and selection was always together. And that was really is amazing how it works, or how it worked. I don't think we could work again now with them, so, because we have been on one level. Really, no, and that was good, respectful, etc. And yeah, so It's a great work. And we are profiting, it's a big profit for us how big, we can have an incredible machine to show and to bring the project all over. Now it's done, but in the years, what was for us very, very helpful. So, but I must say, the major part of the landscaping was us. But we had a big profit from the others, I must say.
Projects like this architect landscape firm relationship. I'm sure there's some in more classic ways, some in more collaborative ways like this. Do you have other experiences working together with architects?
Yeah, I must say it's always a bit different. Depends. We have some really classical, so architects have a project and they're searching for a landscape architect. They call us, do you want to participate? And then we participate. And then we, of course, we work together, and of course, is very close, because I think we are very close to them. But it's a classic, it's the classical way. But there are as well other situations where we started from the beginning, or we did the process together, and then it merges completely. And I think these, we are able to do that. We always liked that. Sometimes we try to do the facades. And or to influence the facades, or and then we said all facades are landscape. And sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't work. And but it is now is already 4 years that we did an architectural branch as well. So now we are. You know, there are a lot of architectural offices who do a landscape branch. So they have two landscape architects sitting there and doing projects. And we did the same, but the other way around. But in, I guess in a better way, because we have a wonderful partner who's sitting in Zurich, and he's doing the architecture branch now. So there is a Topotek One architecture as well, which is small at the moment, but will come. So no, but it's really, we did that in all ways, to be honest. And some architects don't like us because we are talking too much and we are discussing their stuff. And some like us because it's always good for a project to discuss everything. And of course they discuss all the landscape as well, always. But that is good. For a project, it's always good that everybody is looking over the frontiers and looking at the other stuff. If not, it's not a project together. So that's what we always try. Yeah, and that makes fun. So.
Thank you. So first of all, I would like to say thank you, Lorenz. It was amazing and it was very inspiring for us. I myself, I'm a landscape architect, and I know that in the public urban space, there's always a kind of collaboration, and in the meantime, a kind of good way rivalry between different disciplines, architecture, urban design, landscape architecture, and all the other stuff. And my question is, how do you see with new and new challenges are coming in the urban space? So. You mentioned sustainability, but climate change is a quite imminent issue in urban heat island and water and other stuff. Also, you mentioned new societal issues in the urban space. So how do you see these disciplines evolving in the future? Are they getting more and more specialized or super specialized? So there's going to be specialized landscape architect for this problem and specialized architect for that problem. So is it diverging or is it converging somehow? In the future, because we are in an educational institution, and are we going to educate holistic person, an architect, landscape architect type of like very holistic one? or rather a very specialized one? This is the first question. And I got a second question, and this is about your method. So do you have a certain working method? I'm sure you have a certain working method, but is it rather a type of heuristic, very artistic, heuristic process, or very, very technocratic, where every minute you have the certain part of the process and you have to do this and after that? So how do you work in your office? Thank you.
Okay, that's all. Okay, so first question. I don't hope that we get architects or landscape architects for this and for that and for this purpose. So I think and that's what we try, is always to bring everything together. So you've seen, that was not the purpose to show projects which work with stormwater or new planting concepts, etc. I think this has to be part of our work, and it is a part of our work. So we need to be able to deal with all these problems. We need to be able. We don't want to have specialists who work on that. There is something, so for the stormwater, there is a special level where we need sometimes a bit help. When it's getting really, really complicated, then we ask a specialist to work for us, and we integrate some aspects. But we have to, I think, and then we will always do that, I think we need to stay in one profession and to deal with the whole with the whole questions and the whole new questions as well. I hope so. I think for Germany, for Berlin, I would say it will work like that. I guess so. Internationally is always another question. You know, when I compare, we know both the French market because we have projects in France. In France, everything is different. There is the landscape architect is not doing everything. There is an engineer who has the power. The engineer is doing the landscape architect is doing the concept, and then the engineer takes three quarter of the work. The engineer takes. They are doing that somehow. This is not our way. I hate this, and because they're doing that badly, and we can do that better. And I guess, but I think it is possible. So we try, and we changed as well. So we planting concepts are not, I would say, the genes of our office. No, it's something we do. It's something we like. There are more projects with plantings, with planting, with strange planting concepts. There would be another a lecture, strange planting concepts. But it is the need really to find the right plant and the change of the climate change is a very big issue for us. So it has a big, much bigger value and much bigger impact than it had 20 years ago. So it changed. But I think that's interesting. And the stormwater management, 20 years ago, yeah, there was a concept, very simple concepts, but it changed. But I think, and that's what we are trying to do everything ourselves. Because that's what we always wanted, to do everything without roof, in the area, in the open space, and with roof as well, but first without. Second question, what was that? Help me.
It was your working method.
Yes.
Is it a shiny, polished?
No, not at all.
A very organic one.
It's a very organic one. So it's like we said at the beginning, so sometimes there is an idea, and we have that, and it's instant, and it works. Sometimes we have to work for that. So we have to really to make versions, varieties, to sit together. So these are weekly working sessions that we have. We have a team who's working on that, and then we discuss that, and it goes back to the team, and goes back to discussion. So a really interactive working situation. So it depends really. Every project is different, I must say. But we don't like, so it is not in that way strict. There is no strict organization. We hate organization in the office. We have to do that because with five people you don't need organization, but with 50 people you need organization. So we do the organization we have to do, but no, nothing more. So really nothing more. We like this more, this atelier feeling, and we try somehow to preserve that. So this is always it's always an edge. So how much organization do you need, and how much organization and how much chaos you can do? But the chaos is creative. So sometimes it's someone can be the intern who's doing something, and they said, okay, that's it, we're doing it, and we are happy. So it works more like that.
Thank you.
Okay. More questions.
I would like to ask. I was always wondering why in Supercus you have this color, the pink color. It's a very strong color, and as I was listening to your lecture, I was a presentation. I was starting to think that many of the things you create are very strong concepts or very strong statements. And when there is a problem in the way a public space works or doesn't work, then at many times it is important to use, you know, strong statements to get it work. And it's a question whether this color, the pink, and the way it's laid out, or, you know, the color concept also, is it coming from the problematic of the immigration or of the neighborhood, of the problematic of the neighborhood? Because you're also saying that at many times they're like a little bit like doing public artworks, not temporarily, but you know, that stay there for a longer time. And what is interesting when you were saying that people were liking it so much because they could connect to it, that they weren't destroying it. And in public art, there is this this knowledge that when you create something very lovable, then, and that people can connect to, especially if they were involved, then they do not destroy it. And that's quite interesting. And this was what I was thinking throughout your presentation, that it's sort of coming together. And I was starting to understand this as also something strong because of the big problematic that there is in this area. And I was just wanted to ask if this is true, because I was always wondering about whether you really need so much color in such a surrounding, and maybe this could be the answer.
Very interesting, thanks. I did not talk about that issue because it would have taken too long, but I can, so it's very easy. So in the end, I said the basic is the selection of objects, but we had the feeling that we as well, there is another theme, that is how to organize that, because you can't throw them somehow inside in this chaos. So you need a system, organizational system. And as well, the park itself had for us three different parts. So so there is this pink one, which is the most visible. There is what is the lines. They appear a bit gray there. No, you see that gray part, and then the green part, the long green part. So and these, but these areas have been more or less there. So to be honest, the green part was green, and therefore that it is so narrow in the end, that was the only use. And we said, no, we need green, so this stays green. The black situation was a black market, was a real black market. So they was a they sold things and our first idea was to keep that. But it was not possible. So it, just the name black market. So it's called black market, and it was black and black with these lines. And the red square, which is the real big square, in the end, the red came out of the buildings. These are brick buildings. There's a lot of brick outside, and the brick brought the red. For us, it was more red, to be honest. And the idea was red, and it turned a bit into you. So the red square, because of the red buildings. So we had this, the red square, black market, and the green hills or whatever. So that was the frame for all that. And we thought with this strong frame, we could allow us this chaotic system of objects. And the objects then, they behave somehow to the color, and they behave somehow. And then we had as well a kind of order, or we can put them. So this was the way we worked on the project. And of course we like these colors. So it's very simple. We like that. And we thought as well that on this square, it could be interesting to have this kind of whiff, this kind of color, this kind of bit pop. I mean, in the end, this is a trash park. This is trash. This is pop and trash. So we thought that this would look good. There is another story, which I didn't tell because I didn't talk about that. After we finished that, we had problems because this kind of color was badly done. So it was slippery. Shouldn't be like that. It was slippery partly, and then we had a fight with the firm who did that. And in the end, we lost the fight because the client didn't support us. And because partly it was restored, it was not a problem, and the client. But in the end, the firm was very, very powerful, and that what I think BIC didn't support us in the right way, so we lost that, and it's changed. It's not anymore like that. So the whole square is now brick, which is okay, because brick and brick works very well together, and we preserved the same forms. Yeah? So now we have a kind of, the colors are not exactly the same, so this is now is good Danish taste. It's not anymore trash, it's good Danish taste. But instead of letting the firm renovate the situation, they changed the surface. And it works, but it's a bit less fun. But it works, to be honest, it
this
works.
This was a temporary public art installation then.
So if you ever go there, you will see a very tasteful a red square in brick. So, but in the end, I think for us it was really we needed a kind of frame. We needed a very strong frame for this concept. And and it's of course it's always about identity. No, it brings an identity. It brings a very, very special identity. But what is interesting as well is that the most published area is the black market. Well, it's like that. Okay.
I would like to ask that at the first project, how long time ago it was made?
The monastery, the Green Monastery, we finished 2014. 14. And then we worked on one part up to 16, I guess. So it's, but the major part is 6 years old now.
Then my question is wrong, because I thought about that with the issue of sustainability. Would you do it slightly differently today or do the same? Because in one hand, of course, it has got a very expressive architectural less is more feeling. It's very important, I understand. But in the other hand, it's a huge water and energy waste.
It is. I don't know, to be honest. I don't know. So projects are always, the concept is always time related as well. So we must say that the whole project is much bigger. So there are a lot of areas outside of the old monastery, which we did in a very, I would say, in a very sustainable way, where there is not this kind of sharp frame and no watering, etc., etc. So it's a very different concept outside. And inside the walls, inside the old walls, we had we did this concept as well to distinguish between outside and inside. And I think I would do it again. Anyway, the water is coming from downstairs, so the water is not coming from the city or whatever. So the water is coming from the same situation. So we had a kind of, how is it called, fontaine. So we're organizing our own water there. But it is right, it is, it costs as well. So it, the maintain, because it is maintained in the same way, and it works very, very good, the maintenance costs as well. But that was a decision together with the client, said, no, we're able to do that, we want that here. In other situations, we do that differently, but there, in this special area, we want that.
Yeah, if there's an outside and inside, it's clear, of course. It's
there is a second monastery, a second part of the monastery outside, and there is a kind of landscape outside. So for us, it was as well interesting to have this inside outside, but they didn't show that. But I must say, is less a question of water if we are able to find the water on site and organize that in a good way. Firstly a question of money. Is it possible to preserve that? And apparently, because of its amazing UNESCO World Heritage, and it's not so big. To be honest, it's not so big. It looks bigger than it is.
It's very big.
No. And the regional state is Hessen, is a German partial state who is responsible for that. And they decided that, and they said we can afford that. We are able to do that. We are able to do the works. And I must say, I was not sure, but it works. So there. It's in a perfect shape, but this is part of the concept, I must say. If not, we would need a completely different concept.
Thank you.
I got the microphone, so I ask my question that I was thinking to ask. We are landscape architects, actually, and you mentioned the participation topic. And I'm just wondering if you have any experiences about successful participation. We did some community planning during the years, and the first one was really successful. The inhabitants who participated in this process were really friendly, and they supported us, and they participated with a lot of pleasure, and they were really enthusiastic. But there was another project when the people who were mainly elder people, they were like enemies, and they didn't want any changes. And the first question of the question was, why are we here? Why do we want to change anything? And I'm just wondering if you have experience about this, what makes participation successful, and how to involve the people to have a good process together.
This is always it's always different, and is for us what we had different participation processes, but I must say the only process where really I must say, which is really well done, was this at Superkiln. All other participation processes where we have been part have been much shorter, and very, very different, I must say. So, for example, for the monastery, there was a kind of participation process as well, because part of the monastery was occupied by the society of the city, and we had a lot of conferences, speeches with the city and the people how to create that, and that turned, I must say, 2 years as well. So it was 2 years again, and I remember we had articles, incredible articles in the newspapers, and they said we are completely stupid, and so it was very hard. And we had always to sit back and say, okay, we'll do it again. Okay, let's wait some weeks, and then do the next meeting and the next presentation. So I have not an idea. I think you need, for a good participation, you need a lot of time. This is what I learned. You need time. And of course, a bit money, because time is always money. It is always good to calculate a bit time for that. That helps. This is not a recept. It's not a but that helps always, because you can go forth and back, and that's always good, because if you're forced to convince in a very short time, and it doesn't work, what are you doing? So if you have time, you can go, you can do, say, okay, we think about that, we come back and try to find solutions as well, but try to let them understand that you're listening, and this takes time always. So this is the only thing I can maybe add. That we are not too focused, not too stressed time-wise. But and then the question is, are there different ways to do that? Can we do presentations? Can we do a big publicity in the newspapers? And all this stuff that helps. So the newspaper is, for different projects, we always ask our client, you need to get the articles in the city, in the newspapers. You need to publish that someone else is telling what is good, and not you. No, someone else is telling, and that somehow helps as well. But as well, that needs as well time. Mm-hmm. So I guess there are always different levels, different aspects, and. But I don't have the right way. Unfortunately, it would be great.
Thank you.
Okay.
Maybe since we've gone a little bit long. Maybe if there's one last question, we can do it and kind of slowly wrap it up. And there's still drinks and everything in the back. So anyone else?
No, so. Now it's done. No, so. thanks a lot from my side. For a long time. I think we have been more than 1.5 hours here. That's long. Thanks very much, and for the nice question, for the good questions, that's always great.
Yeah. Thank
you.
Thanks again.